Muhammed Usman Diplai is an iconoclastic personality in Sindhi literature and language. He is unique in the sense that he had started his career from a very puritanical, orthodox, and religiosity-oriented party, that is Jamaat Islami, which in fact opposed Muslim League in those days, but later on jumped to the bandwagon and started espousing the cause of Pakistan. Hamida Kolo had written somewhere that the message of Pakistan was popularized in Sindh not by the Muslim League leaders or intellectuals, but by Usman Diplai through his writings against Congress hegemony and Congress misrule and Congress hatred of the majority Muslim population. So in a way, Diplai played an important role in propagating the Muslim League's message via Jamaat Islami platform. I compare him with great English pamphleteers like John Milton and John Bunyan, who would fight for the cause of anti-monarchy and commonwealth through pamphlets. He was a pamphleteer par excellence, in the sense he wrote hundreds of small booklets against the conservative dark practices, sociological and ethnological practices symbolized by the peer parasti. The curse of peer parasti in Sindh is centuries old. I would call it as a continuation of the Brahminical rule, which was there before 1712 AD, that is the conquest of Sindh by the Arabs. But somehow or other, the newly converted Muslims thought of monopolizing the political, the cultural, and economic hegemony or domination of Sindh through conversion to Islam and retaining the beneficial aspects of Hinduism. So I would call peer parasti as a continuation or as an extension of the Aryan Brahminism in Sindh in the garb of new religion. So peer parasti was indeed a curse of the society, and the only person in those days in the early 20th century who raised the flag of rebellion against this curse of peer parasti was Muhammed Usman Diplai. And he did it not through speeches or through letters to the editor, but he wrote pamphlets, and these pamphlets hit the nail on the head, and people indeed they were impressed by Deobandi's Maulvis also, and Jamaat Islami is also a branch of Deobandi school of thought. So Deobandi Islam was mixed with popular Islam as preached by Usman Diplai, and it did a lot. But as luck would have it, after the creation of Pakistan, the Sindhi Muslims found themselves again in a dilemma. This dilemma was that what they had fought for in Sindh was actually the autonomy, the greater autonomy of Sindh, as promised in Pakistan or Lahore Resolution. Our great leaders of Muslim League, like G.M. Sayed, was staunch believers in provincial autonomy, but Muhammad Ibrahim Jio in those days had realized that the promise of provincial autonomy would never be realized, and he wrote his historic book Save Sindh, Save Continent. In that he had expressed apprehensions about the promises made by Muslim League, means Federal Muslim League, Central Muslim League, which was dominated by the Nawabs of UP and CP and Talukadars of Awadh, and the Punjabi converts from Sikhism to Islam, now styling themselves as Unionist, and Muslim League's all promises to Sindhi Muslims were trashed, and hence there was a metamorphosis of personality of Usman Diplai. He converted to secularism, Sindhi nationalism, and a staunch provincial autonomist. He took up cudgels through his press, through his books, mostly short novels, and of course through his editorials, against all the injustices which were being perpetrated to the Sindhi Muslims by raising the slogan of, in a different way, we want greater autonomy. He supported the GSN movement of Hyderabad Chatoi, and of course later on GMC has also articulated the same ideas by uniting all the Sindhi intellectuals, poets, writers on one platform and forming Bazme Sufia Sindh. Though Diplai was of no Sufi, as his background was that of a Puritan Muslim who believed in actually the Deobandi school of thought, but the newly converted Diplai was a very firebrand orator. He led, joined, and of course led through his pen a very strident movement against one unit colonization of lands in Sindh by the army and the Punjabi settlers, and the threat which was imposed upon Sindhi language of the threat of extinction through Ayub Khan's Sharif Commission report, which wanted removal of Sindhi language from the syllabi and institution of Urdu as medium of instruction right from the primary up to the university level. This multipolar fight or struggle against colonists or struggle for the restoration of Sindhi's rights of land and settlement scam was also a great threat to Sindhis, because all the property left in Sindh by the Hindus, who perhaps thought that they would return back to Sindh very soon, because the Congress had promised to the Sindhi Hindus that Pakistan won't survive beyond 6 months and everybody will come back home, and most of the Hindu Sindhis of bona fide credentials, who were the intellectuals, our philosophers, our poets, never seriously believed that Pakistan would survive, as they thought that Congress had better vision of the United India, and after the demise of Jinnah, maybe the country would reunite. But the newly imported ICS class, and mostly the newly inducted CSP class, which for 2-3 years there was no CSP exams even in at the federal level, was recruited by Liaquat Ali Khan from his coterie of favorite students of Aligarh University, and most of them never even appeared in the CSP exam, and they were mostly recruited from the HSN College in Punjab, or from the, it was called the King's College in Punjab. And it was again, the newly CSP class was well entrenched in their hatred of Sindhi nationalism. So they started this hideous law of resettlement of property, any property which was worth more than 500 rupees would not be given to Sindhi Musliman. And all properties would invariably be marked as 5,000, 10,000. So 500 rupees you can't, 5,000 rupees you can't imagine any big bungalow or big mansion could be purchased in 5,000. So this law was definitely adversarial to the Sindhi people, and the Sindhis fought against it. But as I told you, the Sindhi leadership in those days was in agitational mood, but they did not have the mass support. There were no leader like Zulfikar Ali Bhutto who could lead them to the streets. So there was no street power of Sindhi masses as witnessed post 70 or pre 68 period, symbolized by Bhutto's revolutionary politics. So Sindhis mostly confined themselves to writing poems, meeting at Sindhi Adabi Sangat, and that's Basme Sufia Sindh. So it was mostly an intellectual battle, battle of words, which obviously we could not have won because Sindh was abolished in 1955. And the worst part of it, that all the Sindhi feudal lords, jagirdars, peers, meers, all big fiefdoms of Sindh joined together and they voted for one unity scheme. Only one or two persons like Mir Ghulam Ali Talpur who opposed it was very shabbily transported to Mithi and confined to prison. And GM Said was not a member of, I think GM Said was a member, but he did not come or vote. So there was little opposition, and all these people whose forefathers had voted for a resolution in favor of Pakistan in 1945 in Sindh Assembly again regrouped to sign the death warrants of Sindh by voting for one unity scheme. So the same the next generation of those feudal lords now voted for the extinction of age-old historic sin by signing the death knell of sin in the shape of one unit scheme. So that scheme had very negative impacts on Sindhi society, as Sindh name was not even to be written on the letters or on the envelopes. Sindh became, obviously it was the name of Sindh was obliterated from all the academic books, from the postal correspondence, and there was no Sindhi channel. Sindhi newspapers were very few and far between, and very meek and very feeble, and of course without financial clout, because in those days the corporate moguls which you find today in the Sindhi media didn't even exist. So it was mostly a very crusade type freedom fighters who were fighting for Sindh in Karwan or Hilal Pakistan and Ibrat. Diplai Sahib was one of these freedom fighters in the sense, freedom from the hegemony of the center, freedom from the hegemony of Urdu language, freedom from the stranglehold of the army settlers. So he was one of the vanguards in this struggle, in this battle for the restoration of Sindh's original historic identity, which was, of course, a Herculean task, because he was always without any means of communication. I always found him, when I was in school, I would see him in Gari Khata, always walking. So he was a walking philosopher. He never had a proper means of transportation. He used public transport. He would be seen eating and talking like a real Diogenes. I said, Diogenes in Selsky, he was a walking thinker who would think on his feet. He was not an armchair ideologue. He was not an ivory tower poet, philosopher. He was a people's philosopher, in a sense. Diplai's uniqueness lies in the sense that Diplai was a self-made person. He knew the art of reaching the masses through his pamphlets, through his newspapers, used for an magazine, Insan. Now, Insan, in the age of Insan, he becomes a truly different Diplai, who believes in Darwinism, who believes in Abraham Lincoln. Who believes in freedom of expression, with there are translations from Tolstoy, from Rousseau, from Voltaire in Insan. So this Insan magazine was also a mind-boggling, eye-opening thing in Sindhi journalism. It did not follow the traditional style of old guard Sindhi journalism, where Gulabulbul thinks and people who belong to certain parties and who had stranglehold over Sindhi Adabi Board. He did not believe in that Gaddi Nashin type literatures, because in Sindhi, one of the backwardness of Sindhi journalism was that it was dominated by great Gaddis also, as Mehran newspaper was being published by Kingri House, of course, which is belongs to Peer Pagaro. And in the same way, when Shakur Munshi also was also a very docile type of man who would not raise his voice, and Qazi Akbar was also very, in a way, tactful and in a way, very pro-establishment type of man who had participated in the infamous elections of 1947, who had defeated G.M. Syed on the ticket of Muslim League, and that was the first election in the history of Sindh where bogus voting was given official sanctity. The workers, the students of Aligarh Muslim University or MAO College came all the way from Aligarh and stuffed the ballot boxes in favor of Qazi Akbar. And it was the first ever election in the history of Sindh which was rejected by the election commission, and Qazi Akbar's election was held null and void. Nobody writes about this now. Of course, G.M. Syed was defeated by Qazi Akbar, but it was through sheer manipulation of the Muslim League workers. And this was a very shameful episode in the history of Sindh, when Muslim League used its workers, students, and unfortunately, this black legacy of stuffing the ballot boxes was started by Muslim League student wing, and it is now continues in Sindh. It is now a very sanctified official practice. The whomsoever is in power has no chances of losing elections. Of course, it was, I would say, the foolhardiness of Yahya Khan, who did not interfere in the elections in 1970. And allowed Awami League to win elections through popular mandate in East Pakistan. And of course, Bhutto Sahab also was the winner in West Pakistan. But maybe, as some people say, that Bhutto Sahab had certain underhand agreements with the people, that powers that be. But Bhutto's victory was anticipated by the army, but Mujib's victory was never expected by the army. So you now see the ultimate end result was that the Bengali majority's mandate was never accepted, and G.M. Syed was senior vice president of Awami League in those days. He fought election against Malik Sikandar, And initially Malik Sikandar refused to even apply for the ticket from the Sun constituency, Sun Kotri constituency. But GM Shed was defeated through the sheer magnetic power of Bhutto's charismatic personality. And I recall I was a student in B Honours Part 2, English department, and I had a few friends who were with me. They had come from Dhaka and they called me the same night at about 10 and they were crying, "Why GM Shed has been defeated?" I said, "People's mandate." They said, "People's mandate what?" "We thought GM Shed is a very popular person." I said, "He is popular amongst intellectuals, amongst the literati, amongst the thinkers. The masses of Sindh still are following Bhutto's credo, and Bhutto is a very popular man, and you can't deny that." Well, anyhow, GM Shed was a source of inspiration for Diplai in that period, that is post-49 period. It was GM Shed's thought, GM Shed's ideology, Ayaz, Tanvi, Hamayuni, Niyaz Hamayuni, and all those Jamal Abro, Siraj, Ibrahim Joyo, who were the leading lights of Sindh's renaissance, in a sense, the freedom, Sindh's freedom from hegemony of the center, hegemony of Punjab. And he was one of the fighters, Usman Diplai, in that caravan, cavalcade of thinkers, cavalcade of writers. And of course, the new consciousness which you find today in Sindhis. I was, during that tenure, I had a chance to go through the old files of Hur movement. And I was surprised that the only person in Sindh who would write in fiction, who would dare to write in fiction, was Diplai. Diplai had, as a well-known fact, had been thrown to jail for writing a very fiery book, Sheikh al-Mashaykh, and that book was full of unparliamentary type of language on both sides, because it was in response to a book against GM Shed. So this was a rejoinder to that book against GM Shed. He wrote a Sheikh al-Mashaykh. The language was little unparliamentary in a sense that it became too awami. And the awami language was very provocative for the chief minister, who happened to be the disciple of that peer. So he was thrown to jail, and in the jail, luckily he had some Hur companions, and these Hur companions related to him, narrated to him the stories of Hur women. And then when he came out from the prison, he wrote a very historic novel, Sangar. Now, this is the first ever book in Sindhi which symbolizes Hur struggle. Now, Hur chapter has two aspects in Sindh. The urbanite Sindhis, like Hindus, and they are Sindhi Muslims too, a businessmen community or the government officials, they had an adversarial view of Hur movement. They thought Hurs were not law-abiding and they were terrorists. And then you have seen the book, The Terrorist by Lambrick, who was Hur commissioner in Sindh. But as a student of history myself, I thought this movement was again unique in history of subcontinent. Because Subhash Chandra Bose had been fighting a guerrilla battle in Assam and in Bengal and in those areas of which are in far in the east, eastern Asia. So he's, I would say, Surya Basha or Sipkitra Shah I was a guerrilla fighter in a way. He might have hit his personal grievances in the beginning, and when he was young, he was arrested in a case where Mahmudin Jinnah came all the way from Bombay to defend him. But Diplai had magnified this struggle through literature. You see, when history is converted to literary channels, it becomes more universalized. It is not textbook history, it is people's history. When we read English history or French history or German history, you find these characters, when they appear in fiction, the Abraham Lincoln of fiction is more popular than Abraham Lincoln of Washington Post. So he fictionalized the whole war movement. And I think this is a permanent, a durable, you can say, heritage piece now. I worked with Dr. Baloch also, and Dr. Baloch was also incidentally horrified by his spiritual leanings, but he never imposed that ideas on us. Myself being a very secular man, don't believe in peers and muris and things like that. But I would still give Diplai credit for popularizing a movement which otherwise in Urdu was deemed to be डाकुओं की ये किस्म की तहरीक थी एक्वेटिम विद अमीर अली थक्स दास्तान दिस इज दिस दास्तान इज डिफरेंट फ्रॉम अमीर अली थक्स यू नो देयर अ वेरी फेमस थकी मूवमेंट इन इंडिया इन 18th सेंचुरी बट दिस मूवमेंट इज नॉट ऑन इज नॉट कंपेरेबल विद दैट अमीर अली बिकॉज द कन्फेशंस ऑफ बिहार एंड द टेररिस्ट ऑफ कोर्स दे आर very much exaggerated, and they had been spies in the style of Arabian Nights by Lamrick. But Lamrick is also a party. Lamrick was an executor, a prosecutor, a witch hunter of worse. So he is no impartial historian, though he written another book on an introduction, a general introduction. And Lamrick was in a way very reliable historian of Sindh when he writes Introduction to Sindh, but in The Terrorist he has given the darker side of Sindhi culture, and he has printed Hoor movement as essentially terrorist. So actually in the entire subcontinent, if you go through history, the first ever martial law was imposed in Sindh. So that gives us a sort of sense of pride also. The Sindhis were, as per the misconception of the non-Sindhis, the Sindhis are not a martial race. There are people in Pakistan who pride on their being a martial race. They are in the army because they are martial race. The Sindhis are not martial race. So this belies the misperception or propaganda against Sindhis. The Sindhis are very docile, passive type of people. Sindhis activism, Sindhis militancy, Sindhi's fight for justice is epitomized through this novel, which is written by our great writer Diplai Sahab. Diplai's character is, I would say, that belongs to the past era. Now, journalism in Sindh has become commercialized, has been commercialized, and Diplai belonged to the pre-commercial era. So I think in today's Sindh, Diplai would have really regretted being born in Sindh. Now it is a one-liner journalism, it is a soundbite journalism. Diplai was a very thinking, a very literate, and a very passionate person who believed in hurmat, lafz ki hurmat, mana sanctity of words. What he wrote, he believed in it. Today, in Sindhi journalism, or in English journalism, or Urdu journalism also, what the writers write, they do not even agree with their editorials. You'll find that latest editor, that editorial may not necessarily agree with the views of the letter writer. But here, in today's journalism, editor may not even agree with his own editorial. Whatever they write, they do not believe in that. Very great journalist and very good journalist in Sindh, like Deen Muhammad Wafai, Hafiz Khair Muhammad Odi, Siraj, people like Sheikh Aziz, my friend, Khair Muhammad Khokar, and all others, they, whatever they wrote, they believed in that. And Diplai not only believed in that, but he practiced that. Because his journalism was not confined to his table. He would go out into the mosque, to the mosques, and would implement whatever he was doing. He would lead the procession against one unit. He would lead the procession against hegemony of Sindhi property. He would fight for injustice. He fight against injustice and fight for justice. So Diplai was a person who was, as I said earlier, was a working journalist. His journalism was a very down-to-earth, and you can say that it was journalism which believed into the essentials of it. Which was whatever he preached, he practiced. He was not a hypocrite. He was not a conformist. He had no vested interest in whatever he said. He would not compromise. He wouldn't go to see a mouse. Today it is a big honor for the journalist if they are invited to Circuit House. They would rush to the official functions. I would never find him sitting in any official gathering. He was a people's thinker. He was a people's newspaper man. He was a people's conscience. I would say that people like Diplai are born after quite a big gap. Though Sindh is still producing very creative personalities, very thoughtful individuals, but Diplai is also one of the best and excellent examples Sindh has ever produced.